that was just a little taste. You're going to get a little taste of what Marcus and Laura Pridgen do every day. And so they're going to share what goes on in Jerusalem, what they do in and out of Jerusalem. So they're going to share that this morning. And you are going to be so glad I let them share, because you have to listen to me less. So it's all good. So I would like you to welcome our friends, Marcus and Laura Pridgen.
Thank you. As you can see in the video, they make us work really fast there. My new name is Marca. This is Laura. We'd like to open in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for allowing us to be here for this time and this place, Father. We see your fingerprints all over the lives of the people that's in this room. We see how you're working in each one of our lives, Father, and the ministries that you've called each one of us to. And Father, you give us the strength and the peace and the joy and the endurance to do what you've called us to do. We're honored, we're privileged, and we're humbled by what you do in our lives, Father. Thank you in Yeshua's name. Amen. So we just want to thank you for allowing us to be here to speak. Thank you, Pastor. This is my sister here, and my niece is back there, and Hunter is there. And we just thank you. We're with family, all of you are family. I get the privilege of being a driver there. And I get to deliver inside Jerusalem. I get to deliver food outside Jerusalem. Some of the people that I get to deliver to are Holocaust survivors, which still have their tattoos on their arms. And it's amazing to be able to see these people, to be able to share with them. I don't speak much Hebrew, neither one of us do, just a little. But it's amazing when you walk in and you see them and they see you. And words doesn't need to be said so much. As you see in their face, and we get to shine the love of Yeshua into their lives. And I'd like to, my wife, I'm nervous, I'm sorry, I'm just nervous as I can be. But I'd like for my wife to share with you what she does there.
Well, I'll let you first know how we got started in Israel. In 2006, I took my son, my 15-year-old son and I, on a tour to Israel. And we were, we had the privilege of touring the food distribution center there at Bridges for Peace. And I said, I need to get involved with this organization. So God put it on my heart, that's what I'm supposed to do. And when we got back to the U.S. from our tour, I learned that the Bridges for Peace was moving from Tulsa, Oklahoma to Melbourne, right here in our backyard. I'm like, wow, okay, God, you really laid it on my heart there. And so I worked for Red Cross at the time, and I just kept praying, okay, God, you laid that on my heart. Show me, what am I supposed to do? And so a year later, in 2007, I was a full-time staff member at Bridges for Peace in Melbourne as their stewardship manager. And so that's how it all started. And in 2012, we were married. So one Friday at our staff meeting, I said, they were giving announcements, and somebody, our national director, said, there's an opening in Israel for something that I wouldn't mind doing. And I'm like, oh, okay. So I thought, let's go to Israel. So I go home, I said to him, I said, what do you think about moving to Israel? And he said,
what? You expect me to give up my job? I've been here 23 years, we have a home, we have a life. No, you're crazy. Never say no to God.
So that got the ball rolling. So within 9 months, we put our house up for sale, sold it within the first week.
Wow.
Everybody was thinking, okay, what are you going to do with your cars? We want your cars. So our cars were spoken for.
And a motorcycle.
And a motorcycle. Yeah, and then we had 10 yard sales, and our life dwindled to 5 to 6 boxes, tubs. And that's our life in storage now. So we moved to Israel, and I work as the international accounting office, and I see all the donations that come in from around the world to help put food on the table that Marcus gets to deliver to the people of Israel that need it so desperately. And then, he said he wasn't going to talk much. But anyways, then when we come to visit and give you guys updates of where we are and what we do. And this time I was like, okay, God, what do you want me to speak about? There's so many things I can say, you know, talk about. So he gave me the good, the bad, and the ugly.
I still forgot my phone.
You still?
Thank you, yeah, there.
So we want to talk to you a little bit about the good that we have there. We have relationships and friendships from around the world, because we have other volunteers from around the world there, so we get to share with their culture and their food and their language. So it's awesome. We bring smiles and love to the Holocaust survivors, helping those in need, and Shabbat. Shabbat, that is something that you have to experience. You have to, just one weekend, I challenge you to do this. Shabbat there starts Friday night at sundown. So at 3:00 on Friday afternoon, you just start feeling a hush come around, say Port St. John. Just everybody starts settling down. All the cars are off the road. All the stores are closed. Everything's just quiet. And that's for 24 hours from Friday sundown to Saturday sundown. Try and be without internet, without electricity. Electricity, yeah, you gotta have air conditioning. But Shabbat is meant for time for you to be quiet with God. And it's a commandment. It's one of the Ten Commandments. And how, you know, we keep all the others by not murdering or coveting. But why can't we be quiet with God just 24 hours? So I challenge you on that. And then we get to see the land where Jesus walked and talked. So it's pretty cool. It's an awesome thing. Do you want to add to the good?
Well, like I said earlier, I get to visit and deliver to people. It's amazing to me when we do have interpreters where I can understand, they tell their story of what they've went through. And through all of that, they have such a wonderful spirit. They have such an amazing life. And they never give up. They've been through all that. When you're in Israel, it's a land of war. It's a land of unpeace, unrest. But the people there, they love life. Life is precious to them. And no matter what happens to them or to others around them, they're there, and they love, and they love, and they love. So God has sent us there to be able to love them. And it's amazing to be able to get to do that, to shine Yeshua's love. So this is one of the Holocaust survivors that I get to deliver to. And it says, it's not just the food I am thankful for. It's the fact that you remember me and came to visit me, that you carry all that food up all the stairs to my apartment. And there, the higher the apartment is, the cheaper it is. And most of the buildings do not have elevators. So the Holocaust survivors are 80, 90 years old. It's hard for them to climb 4 or 5 flights of stairs. So when we show up and we're able to give them, it's just a little bag of food, but it's so much more than that. On it, it says, from Christians, it's the love of Christ that we get to share to them. And they're so happy to see you. They're so glad that you came. Just a handshake or a hug or a smile speaks volumes of Christ's love to them.
Yeah.
And I'm very blessed and thankful to be able to do that. So the next slide, please.
Okay, the bad. It's bad being away from our family and friends. We've been away now 3 years, and we have 3 more years. When we go back, we'll have 3 more years to go. Adjusting to the new culture, the language, the driving, the conveniences of door-to-door trips and grocery shopping. No Walmart there. You know, you guys really need to be thankful for Walmart. You really do. I think we've been to Walmart every day since we've been here. But anyways, it's think about this, okay? You guys get to go out your front door, jump in your car, go to the store, jump out of your car, go to the store. This sounds easy. It's the normal way of life. But there, it's not so easy. You climb down 4 flights of stairs. You walk 10 minutes to a bus stop. The bus is probably another 30-minute ride, and no personal space. You're sitting right next to a stranger, touching them. You're kind of like, oh. No personal space. They're in your face. And everything. But anyways, and then you get off the bus, and you have to walk to the store. Well, then it depends on what's on your list. Because there's a store for groceries, a store for pharmacy items, a store for hardware items, a store for just, and if one grocery store doesn't have it, you go to a different grocery store, and it's a lot of work. And then now you got to carry all that stuff with you to the next store. And then back on the bus, and then back up 4 flights of stairs. So it's hard. We've lost weight while we got there, but then we got here, and then if you have no buses, sometimes they go on strike. They're like, so they strike. What are you gonna do? You're gonna walk, and it's uphill both ways.
And sometimes in the snow, it does snow
there. Oh yeah, it does snow there. And then sometimes, what's really hard too is watching people suffer and finding a church family. We don't have a community church there because the Christians there, you don't find a whole lot of them. And if they are there, they're tourists or only short-term people. You know, they're 3 months or like us, maybe 3 years or so. But you don't get that connection. You don't get that family community feeling. So that's hard. Okay, and then we're gonna do ugly. The ugly is the terrorism there. It's scary, but you know, it's what Israel's used to. It's their way of life. They're always on the defense, you know, and it's hard. We were there in 2015 when the protective edge, which was when Gaza was shooting rockets into Israel. There was over 500 rockets a day coming into Israel. And you know, we're used to rockets going straight up and keep going up. Well, these rockets are aimed at people. They're aimed at communities. They're aimed to hurt people. And that's a different than rockets here.
Nobody ever shot a rocket at me. This was something new. This was something interesting. But yet at the same time, it wasn't something that was fearful to us. I mean, many times we had to run to our bomb shelter and, you know, hunker down until the rockets had stopped. But in that time, the rest of the neighbors in our building would come down and we would have that time, and they asked, when are you leaving? I know this is, I'm sorry. But they asked, when are you leaving? And we're not. Well, why not? Because God has called us here. God has called us here to be here at this time in this place, to love you, to support Israel. And they're amazed. They're amazed. I deliver next to Gaza, and there's a little town called Sderot. While I was there, just moments before I got to my stop, a rocket had come in. That was 3 months ago. And that's the way, that's life there. That's how it is. That's day-to-day life.
Yeah, this video that we're going to show you is they have a national drill, just like maybe, oh, we don't even have that here. Hurricane, you have hurricane tracking and all that stuff, but do you have a drill? I'm sure, well, I know like in the northern states where they have lots of tornadoes, they do a drill that everybody gets hunkered down and everything. Well, this is what they do in Israel on an annual basis. We go through a national drill for rockets. Here it is. So I'd have to run downstairs, go out the front door, and run to the bomb shelter. And it's an adrenaline rush, but it's your life. And we had 90 seconds in Jerusalem where he delivered that stroke. They only have 10 seconds. And so most of them, like in this community center, there would be a bomb shelter that everybody would just run to, so you'd be right there. But that keeps us safe, the bomb shelters.
If I could say one thing, though, given all that people ask all the time, are you safe there? I'm as safe as God can keep me. We're all as safe as God can keep us. It could be rockets there. It could be anything here. We can't live in fear. We have to live in the assurance of Yeshua in our life. So, even though that's part of our life, we're thankful. We're so very, very, very thankful for being there. And I would not discourage anybody from going there. Yeah, this happens there. How many things happen here? So.
Yeah. So what we're asking is, let us be your hands and feet to the people of Israel. And we ask you to do that by praying for us. And your financial support, because we now live, well, our five bins are here, our tubs, but we had to make a new home there, and we have a, 500-square-foot apartment that we pay $1,500 a month for. So it's, and how we do that is from family and friends that support us, $10 a month, $20 a month, whatever they can afford. And it is tax deductible if you go through Bridges for Peace. And we ask that you communicate with us. You can Skype us, email us, send us birthday cards.
Mine's March 30th, in case anybody.
Yep. Marcus is in 2 weeks. But yeah, just
happy birthday.
Thank you.
And too, if you hear something, because I know the news here about Israel is scary. If you have a question about what's going on, you heard something in the news or something about Israel, email us. We'll tell you the truth, because we're right there. I mean, we can answer your questions. And then see. And then visit us. Come visit. Israel is a beautiful place. It's got the ocean. It's got the mountains. It's got the desert. It's an amazing place. You got to come ride a camel. That's the highlight. Float in the Dead Sea, you can do that. Come and visit us. And we just wanna show you our land.
So we just want to say thank you for allowing us to come up. Thank you, Pastor, for allowing us to brag on God and what he's doing in our life. Thank you. Thank you.
Anyway, so when I saw that video, I said, I've got to play that for people. Because here's what happens over time. If you're not careful, you become a Christian, you start going to church, and you quit knowing anybody who's not a Christian. Marcus and Laura, where they live every day, are the hands and feet of Jesus. Now, one of the stories I didn't get to tell you, I'm going to tell for you. Is that okay? So they're in their 500 square foot apartment, which is, I don't know, I think this stage is about 500 square feet. But anyway, during Shabbat, when the traditional Jewish people cannot do anything, they can't even turn off light switches. And so so if a three-year-old, if they have a little kid, their little kids will turn on the lights or a light switch or flick a radio on. So they've learned to come and get Marcus and ask him, can you come turn off our radio? Now, instead of telling them they're silly or whatever, or, oh, how, you know, you need to believe something. You know what Marcus does? He goes and turns off their lights for him. He goes and turns off their radio for him because his purpose is to build a relationship with these people, to see that they really are there for the long term. Why? So that they can see the love of Christ in them. And so we're all amazed at what you guys do. And at the end of the service, I'm going to pray for you guys today. Is that okay? You let me? All right, so today I want to talk about something just for a few minutes about creating loving environments. And we do this as a church, and you can do this as an individual. And after Marcus and Laura shared, I hope that you'll look at this message and evaluate your life in the light of these environments and say, God, am I doing these things to reach out to people? Or, truthfully, have we become selfish and self-centered? When you become a Christian, you're really supposed to move from selfishness to selflessness. You should easily move from selfishness to selflessness. But the truth is, sometimes as believers, we actually can become more selfish. We're more concerned about petty things. There's churches right now having worship wars where they're fighting over a style of music. Fighting! I was in a church where they fought over toilet paper. Guys, we've lost what really matters. And let me tell you, you get 500 missiles fired at you every day, and you start to evaluate what really matters. So let's look at the four environments that we create as a church, and I'm going to tie it into how we create these, and then how you can create these. All right, number one, we need a place where we can connect with the unchurched. We're going to be looking at Luke 19 today, a very familiar story of Zacchaeus, a wee little man. And a wee little man was he. You ever heard the song? Jesus entered Jericho. By the way, I was talking to Marcus and Laura earlier about Jericho. You don't want to go there. It's very, very dangerous now. Passing through, and a man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector. Time out. You need to realize what a tax collector was. It was a traitor at that time. The Pharisees hated them so much that they had two different designations. Sinner, which would include robbers, murderers, prostitutes, and tax collectors, which were worse. It's absolutely true. They believe tax collectors were worse. We have a tax collector that comes to our church, and I pick on her every Saturday night when I talk about tax collectors. Anyway, I've had to write her checks. Anyway, all right, and was wealthy. By the way, they could also show up at your house and say, by the way, you owe this tax. Can you imagine one of your friends and family members? You know, the Jews are all family members. They're all children of Abraham, you know. So anyway, he wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore tree, which, by the way, was not something normal for adults. We wouldn't think a whole lot about it, but it was very undignified. Since Jesus was coming that way, Jesus already knew where Zacchaeus was. Jesus was headed towards Zacchaeus, and Zacchaeus didn't even know it. Let me ask you a question. Do you look for ways to meet unchurched people? People have been away from church for years or months or lifetimes. Do you ever look for those opportunities to reach out to people? Number two, where people feel valued. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, what in the heck are you doing in the tree? No. He said, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. And this implied the idea, you know, Zacchaeus had a divine appointment now. See, we talk about seeker-sensitive services where we're sensitive to unchurched people, but the truth is God is already seeking them. We should be sensitive. So we talk about it in our church, that first layer being contact with the unchurched. That's one of the reasons we have things like the Fall Festival. At our church, we consider that a foyer environment, a place where we can reach out to unchurched people, our websites, some of the advertisements we do. We realize we're reaching unchurched. The second place where people feel valued is where we go out of our way. We recognize that we have guests, but we're still family, so we're sensitive to our guests. Our Sunday morning services are that way. We consider this our living room. So in your living room, you're a family. Or if you're Italian, you're a family. But you're aware of guests. So what do? We have snacks. And we have coffee. And we want to make people feel welcome. Most guys, if you go to a party, if you're like me and you go to a party, one of the first things you do if you're a guy is you go and you get a soda or your solo cup, your red solo cup or whatever, because it's something about holding a cup that just, you feel like, you know, you have a barricade. I don't know what it is. But, and so we have people come Sunday morning. One of the first things I tell visitors is, hey, the coffee's that way. So they feel welcome. Do you look for ways to, excuse me, are you sensitive to the needs of others? Sometimes we are so preoccupied with ourselves, we're not even paying attention to other people. I've shown up at churches during a service like this, and they had a business meeting for their members and didn't even think about us being there. I've been to churches where they didn't even greet you. Even worse, I went to a church where they pointed at me and said, you're a guest. Stand up and tell us who you are and where you're from. And I'm a pastor, and I was embarrassed. So I can imagine if you hadn't been to church in years and the pastor said,
tell us where you're from and what you're doing here.
But, you know. Number three, a place where we foster deep conversations. Listen, God made you for relationships. If all you needed was God, every once in a while somebody posts, all I need is God. That's not true. If all you needed is God, he wouldn't have created Eve. What happened? He realized Adam. It's not good for Adam to be alone. He's going crazy. He's like that Tom Hanks movie on the island. He's starting to talk to volleyballs and, right?
Wilson,
thank you. So, you know, and so God said it's not good to be alone. Now that's not just talking about marriage, it's talking about people. Do you have anyone you can share with? Can you have anyone that you can have fan you during the church service to distract the pastor from up front? Now here's what Jesus says in Luke chapter 19. I must stay at, they're back there going like, okay. I must stay at your house today, Jesus said. By the way, that's huge. We just hear that like no big deal. You got to understand, a rabbi, what they considered a teacher, somebody very important, somebody they had heard about, somebody he knew healed people, came to his tree and said, hey, I'm coming to your house. Now, in our modern society, people don't want you at their house. Have you noticed that? Most of you, if I showed up at your house this afternoon uninvited, would be horrified. You would not let me in. You'd be like, could you have given us a few minutes notice before you came? Now, some of you are like, I don't care what my house looks like. But somebody in your house probably does, okay? But people now are horrified. Back then, though, this was such an honor. And Jesus said, I'm coming to your house. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter.
He has gone to be the guest of a sinner.
So they go to the house and people start saying, look who he's hanging out with. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, here I am. I give half my possessions to the poor. If I've cheated anyone out of anything, I'll pay back four times the amount. So what did Zacchaeus do? Now he got in a private setting where they were having a deep conversation. And he said, you know what? You're right. If I've hurt anybody, I want to make it right. You need to be in a relationship close enough to people that when you start to realize some things, by the way, when you talk to people sometimes, everybody is perfect until they actually talk to somebody else. Everybody does great until they get behind the wheel of a car. My pastor used to say, I thought I was so good until I had children. And then suddenly I find all these things about myself I never knew. Anger, frustration. He said, these little mirrors are running around acting just like me. When you get in relationship with people, not only do you find out your brokenness, you ready? You're able to help other people with their brokenness. There's times as a believer that you are carried when you're weak, and sometimes you carry others. When people come to me and say, oh, I don't need church. I say, yeah, but somebody might need you. Maybe you don't need them now. Someday, by the way, you will. But we carry people and they carry us. So let me ask you this. Are you building relationships to foster deeper conversations? That's the reason we have small groups in our church. And if you can't get in a small group, maybe you look at the times and say, I can't do that. Listen, find one other believer that you can have a deep relationship with, somebody that you can trust, and you can say to them, here's where I'm struggling, here's what I'm studying, here's what I'm doing with God, this is my quiet time, this is not my quiet time, you know, whatever it is, so that you can have somebody to share what's going on. God did not want you to be alone. And then are you part of a small group where you're known? One of the key ingredients to our lives is we want to be known. Now, here's how the four environments work at our church. You can think of it like a house. I stole this from somebody. We start in the foyer. This is the next slide. We start in the foyer. The foyer is where we greet our guests. You just barely know them. You don't tell them everything about you in the world. Can you imagine greeting a salesperson at the door and you start going, hey, and then this happened, and then this happened. By the way, it might be a good way to chase them off. Okay? So you just introduce them to you. You get to know them. And then the next is the living room. You invite them over, and you're sensitive to them. If your kids get in a fight in your house when you have guests over, you want to do what to your children? That's right. Make them not exist anymore. I got you, right? Right? You find duct tape or whatever, right? You're thinking, what can I do to these children? So what do? You say, oh, excuse me, just a second. I've got to talk to my kids. Now, children, remember we had a conversation earlier about how we were going to behave with our guests? And most of us have been in a home where a family got in a fight in front of us, and immediately you want to leave. I've been in churches where people have gotten in fights in front of people who haven't been to church in years. That should never, ever happen. And then you talk about the kitchen, that's where you get small groups. And the backyard, that's reaching out to other people. It's where we help sponsor missionaries. Listen, 10%, I mean, everything we do goes to ministry, but 10% goes to local and foreign ministries that have nothing to do with us. I have some friends in the Philippines right now who are missionaries, and part of what you give goes to them. And as Marcus and Laura come today, we're going to be looking at helping their ministry as a church, not just as individuals, but as a church. How can we help them? And then number four, where we help others find their way home. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Jesus is looking at those religious leaders and saying, you think this guy's an outcast, but guess what? He's one of your brothers. He's reminding them that even the person that is the farthest from God, God wants them to come home. Who in your life do you know that needs to come home? Who are you praying for? Is there a missionary you're praying for? I encourage you to take that bulletin home with Marcus and Laura's name. Put it on your refrigerator and remember to pray for them. Pray for them every day. Pray that God would use them. Pray that God would bless them and use their ministry as they take people food that people would say, what is it? Why do you do this? That they would come home to Jesus Christ. So let me ask you a question. Do you serve your neighbors even? I remember taking youth on mission trips around the world. I was in one church where they did mission trips literally around the world. And I would go to some of the kids and go, when's the last time you helped one of your neighbors? Oh, I never helped a neighbor. Well, before you go around the world, start helping at home. What can you do here? Who can you help here? There's several places around here that feed the homeless. There's so many ministries. So many places you can serve. I'm in Rotary. Find somewhere where you can serve your neighbors and your community, and then look for ways. Can you serve around the world? Maybe you go and visit the food pantry, or maybe you go on a mission trip. We're looking at a mission trip for next summer with another church going to Uganda. Yeah, I'll be telling you more about that. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, we're going to pray for Marcus and Laura in just a minute. And then we're going to have our offering. And then I'll be here after the service and you can say, Eric, I want to give my life to Christ today. Maybe you're here and the truth is you've been worried about petty things. Anytime you start to complain, here's what I want you to think. Is this as bad as a rocket coming at me? And if the answer is no, realize I've not even learned how to sacrifice yet. Lord, forgive me. Help me to walk with you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Marcus and Laura, would you come up here for just a minute?